It's like we are back in session, courtesy council person. All members of our jury are all in, so our person, our witnesses, back on the witness stand. And Mr. McGee, you may resume your examination.
Thank you. Can I have 1 second with the court? She asked me a question.
Sure.
Legion Bowles, as we ended yesterday, after the jury left, I asked if you can look at some other cell towers and plotting. Is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
And I asked you to look at beginning and ending towers for different calls up in Victorville.
Yes, sir.
So you're familiar with that now to refresh your memory of what you looked at before?
Yes, sir.
Waiting for other exhibits. One thing that we asked you to do this morning, and I'm going to show you exhibit 907, was to draw on this exhibit the sector for azimuth 170 on the tower on top of the hill in Victor Valley.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to show you 907. Describe for the jury what you did using the pointer on exhibit 907.
Certainly. So I know it's hard to see on the screen, but there are two red lines that have been drawn with a marker, and we used a plastic protractor to find what the sector would be for 170 degrees, which is one of the sectors available for that particular cell tower. And I marked it with the red markers, and then I drew sort of a similar semicircle in the middle just to indicate the direction for that particular sector.
And so, and refresh the jury's mind that azimuth 85 is which two legs on this exhibit?
So 85 is pointing almost due east, so it would be the leg that comes up diagonally through the word California, and the leg coming down at a diagonal that's black, pointing down towards the word Corwin Road at the bottom of the screen.
And azimuth 10 legs are, I believe, the blue ones that don't show up well?
Yes, that's correct. So the 10 degrees is going to be indicated by this dark blue leg pointing to the, I guess it would be the north. West, and then the other end of the sector would be the dark blue leg pointing to the northeast, kind of bisecting the word Bernardino.
And based on your review of the call records, was that azimuth 170 ever used by my client's phone on that afternoon?
It was.
So we know it was operational.
Yes.
And the azimuth 170, is that grouped with, let me strike that. There's two bands on this tower, correct?
Yes.
And each band has three sectional antennas?
Yes.
Do you know which, do you know if azimuth 85 and 10 are on the same band?
I believe they are not. One is 850 and one is 1900, but I don't know. I don't recall which is which, but I know they're different bands.
Do you know if 170 is grouped with azimuth 10 or azimuth 85?
I don't off memory at this point.
I
show you exhibit 912.
Yes, it's 912.
In exhibit 912, what does that show you?
It appears to be locations of cell towers and their respective directions or azimuths.
And does that appear to be consistent with the location of cell towers, approximately what you remember reviewing?
Yes, they look similar to the ones I've looked at, yes.
So that is the general location of all the cell towers that were identified for AT&T in the Victor Valley area.
Objection, vague as to time.
In 2010.
Yes, I mean, without a complete comparison, it does look very similar to the group of towers that I looked at, yes.
Exhibit 913, the next one, you recognize that exhibit?
This is an exhibit you showed me just prior to today's hearing.
And what does that exhibit show?
This is the 10:46 a.m. call on February 6, 2010. Indicates the cell tower and sectors that carried the call from its originating tower and its terminating tower.
And is that consistent with what you saw when you were viewing that house?
Yes.
Demonstrate that exhibit now. Could you take the laser pointer and identify what's the actual tower and what it's showing on that exhibit?
Okay. The tower that carried this call is the cell tower indicated almost in the middle of the screen, and it shows the starting cell using a sector with an azimuth pointing in a northwest direction, and the ending cell with a azimuth pointing in a southwest direction.
And where is that in relation to like downtown Victorville?
Well, the word Victorville is slightly to the east of the cell tower, so it would be just slightly west of downtown Victorville.
And where the gravesite was, that's north off of the page.
Yes, it was north. I believe up kind of in the area above where the black is, where the word time is, somewhere in that area.
So when you say the starting tower is the best for determining, or the most accurate for determining the location of a phone in use, is that a fair summary?
Yes.
The ending tower may not be as accurate by that statement. Would that be fair to say?
Objection. This states his testimony and assumes facts, not evidence.
Yes, so the terminating tower, because it is controlled by the network, it is slightly less accurate than the originating tower is.
But for a ending tower to be used, the phone still must be within that antenna's range.
Yes, it must have a usable signal from that antenna.
So as an example, if we have the ending tower, which was the cell ID of 15772, it's pointing in a southwestern direction. So is it telling you that at the time that call ended, the cell phone would have to be within the range of that tower?
Yes, it would have to have had some usable signal from that tower.
And what's the total time of the call in question?
The 1046 call is, well, the talk time was listed as 3 seconds, but in terms of mapping the cell towers, you include the seizure time, so it would be a total of 30 seconds.
And that tower is on the east side of the 15 freeway?
Yes.
And those two towers would overshoot the 15 freeway?
Objection, misstates his testimony as to two towers.
Excuse me, yes, two antennas.
Sustained error.
Those two antennas from that one, those two antennas on that one tower, the start and ending tower antenna, those would both overshoot the 15 freeway.
Yes, I would expect their signal to bypass the freeway.
Would it be a reasonable conclusion that the subject is in close proximity of that tower, possibly moving?
Objection calls for speculation.
Can you ask that one more time, just to make sure I get it right?
Would it be a reasonable conclusion to say that the cell phone is in close proximity to this tower and possibly moving?
It's within the range of that tower. I would have to say it could be moving, but it also could be stationary.
That's why I said possibly.
Yes.
Okay. Let's see. Exhibit 9. Come on, let me check that. The ending cell. For the ending tower antenna for this call, do you know the height of this tower?
I don't, offhand, sir.
Do you know the placement of this tower?
What do you mean by placement?
Is it on a hill or is it just on a floor or the ground or a building or something like that effect?
I don't know, sir.
And we figured out that the altitude's important, correct?
It adds to the line of sight, which could help with signal strength.
Does the end cell 15772 for this tower on this call, does that appear to be something that could reach where the gravesite was?
I would not expect that sector to have coverage at the gravesite.
Are you familiar with what's demonstrated on that exhibit?
Yes, I was shown this earlier this morning.
And could you describe, I'll show 914. Can you describe what is shown on this exhibit?
Yes, so between 1130 and 1152, there was a series of calls that I believe all but one of them originated at sector pointing at 85 degrees, which is to the east. And then many of those calls terminated on the sector of 10 degrees. And with the approximate coverage width of 120 degrees per sector, it created an overlap. And this yellow shaded area is the approximate overlap area where those two sectors would have coverage.
And the calls that we described, the first one that hit that tower was at 11:30, correct?
Yes, I believe that's correct.
And I believe that one was not answered.
Not what?
Answered.
Objection calls for speculation.
Yes, based on there was a zero seizure time and zero elapsed time. And My understanding from AT&T is that indicates a ring, no answer.
And that was an incoming call?
I believe that was an incoming call from a 1-800 number, based on my memory.
And just in case, I don't want to test your memory or have you say anything that you may not be certain about, I will get to you again, exhibit 794. You can have this handy in case you want to refer to it.
Thank you. It's just, it's hard to remember every call.
Right.
Okay, I think I found our place. And for the record, I'm on page 372.
So then the next call happened at what time?
11:31 a.m.
Was that ingoing or outgoing?
It's an outgoing call.
And what number was dialed?
Well, the number dialed was 226-1197, but it terminated at that same number with an area code of 909.
Do you understand that to be Captain Jarvis's number?
That's what I've been told, yes.
And how long was the capture time? Or your capture time?
Their seizure and elapsed.
Seizure. How long was the seizure time?
Seizure time shows 26 seconds.
How long was the phone call?
3 seconds.
And that call originated again at the cell tower 11095, which is the 85 azimuth?
Yes, sir.
And where did that call, what antenna did it end at?
The 10 degree azimuth, which points more to the north.
So the total length of that call was, from a capture standpoint, for the records, was how long?
29 seconds.
Does the change in the antenna used show possible movement?
Objection calls for speculation.
Overruled, he can answer if he has an opinion.
It could go either way. It could show movement or it could just be a reselection by the network.
It's reasonable to say he's stationary, and it's reasonable to say he's moving.
Yes, I think both would apply in this situation.
And the next call is at what time?
11:32 a.m.
And the 11:32 a.m., what, is that ingoing or outgoing?
It's an outgoing call.
And what number was dialed?
1-909-374-8951.
Are you familiar with what number that is?
Offhand, I'm not.
And how long was the seizure time?
10 seconds.
And how long was the call duration?
2 seconds.
In what tower was the initiating call?
The tower to the north, sector 10. I'm sorry, azimuth 10.
So the 11091 on the exhibit still shown?
Yes.
So if that is the more accurate one, is it consistent then that the phone at the time of usage is likely to at least the north of the latitude of the town.
Objection, misstates his testimony as to accuracy.
Overruled and interferes in opinion.
Yes, the phone would need to be in the coverage area of that particular sector.
And the ending tower?
There is no ending tower for that particular call.
And based on your training experience, is there sometimes reasons why there's no ending tower?
Yes, what I've been told in our training is that that is a possible indicator that the call was dropped because it didn't capture that final tower.
It was probably a lost call.
Lost call, dropped call, I'm not sure, whatever term you like to use.
The next call was at what time?
A.M.
And was it ingoing or outgoing?
Outgoing call.
And what number was called?
The same number that's previous.
So the one ending in 8951?
Yes, sir.
And how long was the seizure time?
27 seconds.
And how long was the phone call?
4 seconds.
Was there a beginning azimuth?
There was.
And what was, which one was that?
It's the antenna pointing at 85 degrees to the east.
And so that's on the same tower, 11095?
Yes, sir.
And was there an ending sector?
Yes.
And which one was that?
11091, pointing at 10 degrees.
So these calls are kind of bouncing between the two sectors of that tower?
Yes.
Both initiating and terminating part of the call?
Yes.
And what's the next call?
11:34 a.m.
And was that ingoing or outgoing?
Outgoing call.
And what number was dialed?
226-1197, and again, that was terminated at a 909 area code.
So we called Kathy back?
Yes, that would be what I've been told is Ms. Jarvis's phone number.
And what was the seizure time?
26 seconds.
And the call time?
2 seconds.
And that seizure time can be either ring time or a directed retry.
My understanding is that seizure time is from when the user requests resources until they're talking on a call. So whatever occurs in that period of time, it may be a number of things.
So it could be ringing the whole time. It could be trying to get a ring to start. It could be looking for a tower that'll accept its resources. It could be doing anything in that time.
Yes, this is the things that are going on between the phone and the network.
And this call, 11:34, what is the initiating tower sector?
11095, the 85 degree sector.
And then what is the terminating tower sector?
11091, which is the 10 degree sector.
So it's consistent, it keeps bouncing between the two, correct?
Correct, I believe the last 4 calls or so approximately.
Going back then to exhibit 914, would it be reasonable to conclude at that point then that the cell tower could be within the yellow area that's the overlap between the two sectors of that tower?
Objection, mistakes is testimony.
Cell tower or the cell phone?
The cell phone can be within the yellow area that's the overlapping sectors of that one tower.
Objection, that calls for speculation based on his testimony.
Yes, it's a possibility that phone exist in an area where there's coverage from both sectors, yes.
It's reasonable. Not certain, though, right?
It's not certain, but it's reasonable.
Because it's fair to say you cannot say with any certainty where the phone was.
Not with this type of analysis.
Going. And on this exhibit, just so we're clear, on 914, is where the gravesite or crime scene located, is that marked on this exhibit?
Yes, I see a blue dot with the words crime scene below it.
And could you point that out to the jury on the overhead behind you?
Certainly.
Just below the yellow pie wedge is the blue dot with the words crime scene.
Now, in the bottom right corner of this exhibit, there's another red resided image with a circle, red circle around it. Do you see that?
Yes.
And it has the words, next to Nazi Trust?
Yes.
Would that icon represent the possible location of a cell tower? Based on the icon?
Yes, that's the icon used in these charts for a cell tower.
Did you confirm that that tower actually exists?
No, I did not.
Okay, let's go on to the next exhibit, exhibit 915. You recognize that exhibit?
Yes, it's one I was shown earlier this morning.
And what does exhibit 915 show?
It's the call at 11:52 a.m. And the two cell towers that the sector that started the call and the sector that ended the call.
And the starting sector, well, they say, is this call ingoing or outgoing?
It's an outgoing call.
And what number was dialed?
Ms. Jarvis's number.
And the seizure time?
20, I'm sorry.
Would that be accurate that's on the exhibit, 26 seconds?
Yes, sir. The total capture time would be 35 seconds.
But the length of talking time is 9 seconds?
Oh, yes, sir.
And the total capture then is 35?
Yes, sir.
So the starting or initiating cell tower sector is the 11095?
Yes, sir.
And the terminating cell tower sector is on a different tower?
Yes, sir.
And this tower is located where? Can you point to it on the map and give a general description of where it is relative to any known landmarks?
Certainly. Down on the bottom of the map, slightly left of center, is marked with a bubble that says NCEL 03483. And it's pointing to Sector 3, just above the words Mountain View Acres on the map.
And is that at the 15 freeway and Palmdale Road?
Yeah, so that appears to be where the cell tower is located.
And that would be just south of the Victorville Courthouse?
I don't know if I've been to the Victorville Courthouse, sir.
Okay. Did you check to see the placement of this cell tower?
I have not visited this particular cell tower, no.
Are you familiar with downtown Victorville?
I've driven through it. I don't visit there regularly.
You remember any tall hills in the middle of downtown Victorville right next to the freeway, that exit?
Adjacent to the freeway, maybe north of Victorville there might be some, but I don't recall all the different terrain up there.
Based on your memory, is it likely that this cell tower is placed somewhere either on a ground or a building?
Objection, calls for speculation.
With this cell tower being at its location, would you expect its range or strength to be limited by the surroundings that can cause interference in its signal strength?
Objection, calls for speculation, lacks foundation.
I'm not familiar with, I am familiar with the desert, and it is generally flat, but I'm not familiar if there are some obstructions in the coverage area of that particular cell tower.
With the total call time of 35 seconds and the change from towers from the beginning or initiation of the call to the termination of the call, would it be reasonable to conclude that the cell phone was likely moving?
Objection, calls for speculation.
I mean, based on the ending cell being at a distance, it's likely that phone moved at least enough to where there was coverage from that secondary tower.
And the initiating tower, the one on top of the hill, that's likely the strongest tower in Victorville?
Objection, that's vague and calls for speculation.
I could articulate it's likely the tallest tower in Victorville. Whether it's the strongest tower in Victorville would depend on where you are in proximity to that tower.
Fair. Would that be viewed kind of like a blanket tower to offer support for the other towers?
I'm not sure if I could answer that question accurately. It'd be speculation.
Fair enough. Is the placement of that tower on top of that hill meant to expand or widen its coverage to be the most efficient for a phone company in their placement of the tower?
Objection, calls for speculation. Mm-hmm.
To the next exhibit.
Before you do that, do you have an estimate as to the distance between those two cell towers?
I don't see a scale on the map, but I'm going with my memory. I believe it's about 6 miles to 8 miles, something in that range. I'd say approximately 6 miles. This is 11:53 a.m.
And that's 1 minute after the last call?
Yes, sir.
And the Is this a, an ingoing or outgoing call?
This is an outgoing call.
And what number was dialed?
1-909-374-8951.
The number he dialed before?
Correct, he dialed this number previous.
At like 1131, 1132 in that one of those calls?
Yes, sir.
And the seizure time of this call?
26 seconds.
And the talk time?
10 seconds.
Total call?
36 seconds.
And the initiating tower is located where?
Would you like me to show you on the map?
Please.
So the initiating tower is where it says start cell, and it's sector 3, pointing in the northwest direction.
And that's the same tower that the last call ended on?
I believe so. Let me verify that. Yes, sir.
Is it the same sector as well?
Yes, sir.
If a call terminates F from one call and the next call is within a minute and it initiates at the same sector, the same tower, does that offer anything to your analysis about the use of the same sector, same tower between termination and starting?
The fact that a call originated from that tower is a stronger to my analysis than the fact that one ended there. But if they are in sequence like that, there's, you know, the phone needs to be in the coverage area of that particular sector.
Is it fair to say that, or is it reasonable to say that the 1153 call, with it being the initiating tower at the sector shown on this exhibit, that the phone is likely in close proximity to that tower?
I could say the phone is going to be in the coverage area of that tower.
Fair enough. And the terminating tower is where?
It's down at the bottom right of the screen. It says end cell 15403, and it's a sector pointing slightly west of north.
And did you research the location of this tower?
I did.
And what can you tell the jury about the terminating cell tower?
It's an elevated tower up on a hillside or the side of the mountain. I believe, if my memory serves correct, I believe it was at about 2,700 feet elevation, where the valley floor, the desert floor, is at approximately 1,700. I think I'm messing up the elevation. I apologize. I don't recall the exact numbers offhand, but I know it was elevated up on a hill by approximately 1,000 feet.
So it's an elevated coverage tower?
Yes, it's similar to the Oro Grande Tower.
But the location is on the other side of Hesperia and Apple Valley?
Yes.
Approximately how far away would that tower be from the initiating tower? And would looking at exhibit 912 maybe give you reference between the 6 mile distance to this distance, since it's the same tower?
Yes, please.
912, I think you have up there with you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
Here, what I'll do.
Well, these are different scales, though. One's zoomed in.
Different scales, but you determined it's 6 miles, right? Approximately from the one tower to the Oro Grande Tower?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I'd say approximately 10 miles.
And I'm going to go back to the exhibit that you're looking at. On this overhead, can you show where the initiating tower and the terminating tower is on the exhibit? You love perspective.
The initiating tower is, I believe it is this one, just above the words Mountain View Acres. And the terminating tower is down to the bottom right near the words Google Earth. Which is kind of up on the side of the hillside there.
And the Oro Grande Tower, or the tower, the main tower that's up near the gravesite?
That's the furthest north tower, just to the right of the words Oro Grande on the map.
And approximately where is the gravesite?
It is approximately this area here. I don't recall exactly where.
If you look back up there, is this not the quarry road? That white line there.
Okay, I wasn't aware that that was called Quarry Road. But
therefore, it assumes facts, not evidence. Move to strike counsel's comments.
And the gravesite is to the east of that dirt path seen there.
Okay.
So, pointing where the gravesite is, and you look down at the terminating tower, do you see any hills in between those two that could possibly affect line sight?
I see hills on the map here, which is for a description, it'd be slightly to the right of the word Victorville. They appear to be some type of hills that are protruding up out of the earth.
Did you check the elevation of those hills in relation to the terminating tower and the gravesite?
I did not.
So you can't say one way or another if they're obstructing a hill?
That's correct.
Exhibit 917. What does that one show?
917 is a call at 12:49. I believe your exhibit says AM. I believe it should be PM.
That should be PM. Okay. And it's at 12:49 PM. Is that an ingoing or outgoing call?
It's an outgoing call. Ms. Jarvis's number.
And what is the seizure time?
8 seconds.
And the call time?
3 minutes and 45 seconds.
So the total call time, 3 minutes and 53 seconds?
Yes, sir.
And the initiating tower is where?
It's in the Victorville area.
Show on the map behind you where it's located.
So the start cell is at, it says start cell 29816, just below the word Victorville on sector 2. And the ending cell label is 03481, which is sector 1 pointing in the kind of a southeast direction.
would it be a reasonable conclusion that the cell phone during this usage is somewhere in the Victorville city area?
Yes, that's a reasonable conclusion.
And does the length of the actual call help in any conclusions you can reach, or is that important?
How can you specify what you mean by important?
Whatever you find is important, is the length of the call of significance to you in any way?
Not as much as the start and the end cell towers.
If you're using this call in a form of apprehension of a subject, where would you start looking for them?
I would look in the overlap area between the coverage area of both of those sectors would be a good place to start.
And the terminating sector is the same tower as the initiating and terminating towers of the previous two calls? One at Palmdale on the 15th?
Yes, sir.
Just a different sector, then?
Yes, sir. Yes, this again was exhibit I was showing this morning for a call at 1:30 p.m.
And was this ingoing or outgoing?
It was an outgoing call.
And to who?
Ms. Jarvis.
And what was the seizure time?
9 seconds.
Clock time?
44 seconds.
And the total call is 50.
Yes, sir.
And the initiating tower is where?
It's the tower to the north on top of the Oro Grande hill.
And
but it's pointing in a sector at 170 degrees pointing south.
And that's the one we added on the other exhibit.
Yes, sir. That's one I drew this morning.
And the terminating tower and sector is where?
It's on the screen at the bottom. It says NCEL 18613. And it's a tower adjacent to the Interstate 15 pointing almost due north. It may be due north. I'm not sure. I have to look.
And that's the tower on the most southern portion of Victorville City area?
Objection, that assumes facts, not evidence.
Oh, I'll leave you answer if you know.
It's towards the bottom of the map. I'm not sure where the city boundaries are, sir.
Thank you.
exhibit 475. Exhibit 475. Here we go. This is the map you created of the calls up in the Victorville Valley area, correct?
Yes, it was one of them, yes.
I noticed there are no azimuths on any of the calls downtown.
No, and this was part of my sort of running record where I was just showing the general cell tower connections throughout the 15 days.
Now you said early on in your testimony on direct that you made the choice not to put any of the azimuths on any of the calls of any of the maps, correct? Based on work intensity, it'd take a lot of effort.
Objection, this states his testimony.
Sustained.
Remember when you said you didn't put all the azimuths for the initiating calls on any of the maps that you compiled for February 1st and 15th?
Other than the one map where I did put the azimuths, that is correct.
And why did you not do that?
For the 15 days, we were looking just for the general movements of where that phone went in the Southern California area. And back in 2014, this had to be done manually, so it took a lot more time to do it. And in my assistance to the San Bernardino County Sheriff's Department, I just did the actual cell tower locations versus the azimuths.
Fair to say that having the azimuths on the calls up in Victorville can be helpful in visualizing the possible locations of the cell phone when calls are made?
Yes, sir.
I noticed on direct, you were never asked an opinion of where the cell phone was. Can you offer any opinion as to specifically where the cell phone was when the calls were made?
Other than it was in the coverage area of that particular tower and sector, I can't locate that phone precisely.
Is it fair to say, with just the limited information you have, that it'd be too speculative to try and pinpoint a phone?
Correct.
Is it also fair to conclude that the only reasonable opinion or conclusion you can make from this data is that the cell phone was in the high desert area?
Yes, I believe that's a fair assessment.
Anything more detailed than that?
No, I mean, you can get general idea of where they were in the high desert, but it still is not very precise. I don't recall if they asked me that specific question, but I would not have answered it to say yes. I would have said that the data doesn't allow that kind of precision.
fair and reasonable to conclude that at least the 1046 and 1249 calls show a cell phone that's likely south of those towers.
Objection, calls for speculation.
Can I refer back to your exhibits just to be sure?
Yes.
You said 1046 and the
1249.
On the 1249 p.m. call, I would agree with you that the phone was likely south of the two towers it connected. On the 1046 call, I would say it was more inconclusive.
Based on the data showing in all the calls and all the towers and sectors of those towers that were hit, is there a reasonable conclusion that between 1046 and 1:30, that cell phone, reasonable say, was moving?
Yes, I would say it's very reasonable to say that cell phone moved, maybe not in a constant fashion, but periodically throughout that time period.
Take our morning recess this time, 15 minutes. Keep in mind the admonitions previously given to you, not perform or express any opinions about the case, not to discuss the case. We'll see everyone back in about 15 minutes.